Jesus said, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength." This is our purpose. But how do we go about transforming our purpose in order to faithfully and effectively carry out the word? The Apostle Paul tells us in Romans 12, "I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good, acceptable, and perfect." I believe it was Herman Baumbach who told about a woman who wandered into a Lutheran church service one Sunday morning. Although it was just as easy as a Presbyterian church service. And as the pastor preached, the woman got so caught up in the message that every once in a while she shouted out, "Praise the Lord!" After a while, the woman next to her got so annoyed that she leaned in and said, "Excuse me, but we don't praise the Lord in the Lutheran church." A man in St. Pew corrected her and said, "Oh, yes, we do. It's on page 19.
And you are.
worship God on a ski slope. I can worship God while watching a sunset. Now, it is true that you can worship God in a garden on a ski slope and while watching a sunset. But it is also true that usually people do not worship God in such places, except in a very vague, offhand way. The Bible does not have a lot of positive things to say about vague, offhand worship. Psalm 150 teaches us that we are to make clear in a particular time and place what is meant to be true at all times and places, and that is, we exist to praise God. If we do not practice praise in a particular time and place, then we will not experience it at any time or in any place. Verse 2 tells us why God is to be praised. God is to be praised for what God does. God created us and sustains us. That in itself is worthy of the highest praise. But here's when the Bible speaks of God's mighty deeds. It is speaking of God's saving acts. An example from the Old Testament would be the Exodus. The Exodus, when God, through Moses, liberated the Israelites when they were slaves in Egypt. This one event shaped entire Old Testament. But the most profound display, the greatest display of God's saving power, is seen in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. Now, if you know what Jesus has done for you, you'll want to praise him. You'll want to praise him again and again and again. Verses 3 through 5 tell us how God is to be praised. And I can't help but be struck by the variety of instruments that are mentioned. Brass, strings, percussion, and more. I'm also struck by all the noise that all those instruments are making. They're all used at the same time. But that is precisely the point. The Hebrew word for praise is hallel. Hallel. And the root meaning has to do with making noise. Especially noise that would make you look foolish. Then later is used to mean exuberant celebration. Now, the word hallel is combined with the other Hebrew term Yahweh to form hallelujah, Yahweh, or hallelujah, hallelujah, praise the Lord. Hallelujah and hallelujah are the same thing. Now, hallelujah is usually just translated as praise the Lord, but it means so much more than that. What hallelujah really means is make a lot of exuberant noise. Because the God who made the universe and brought us into being has personally sought us and mercifully redeemed us. Do I hear a hallelujah?
Hallelujah.
Verse 4. And we are in trouble. It mentions dancing and worship. That can't be in the Presbyterian hymnal, can it? Or in the Presbyterian Bible? Dancing in worship? Well, I think there's a way out of this. In Hebrew, this term has more than one meaning. You know, like in English, words can have lots of different meanings. Like the word bridge can have lots of different meanings. The word charge can have lots of different meanings. Depends on the context, how you interpret it. Well, this particular Hebrew term can also mean having a pained expression on the face. You see where I'm going? So as I look around this Sunday morning, I see a lot of you like this kind of dancing. You know, how we worship them. Hang on. Now, okay, to be fair, this congregation has been very open to the Church of the Lord's Savior dance and worship. And that's great. That's wonderful. How are we to praise God? Well, the short answer is with everything we have and everything we are. We offer our different gifts. We harmonize our diverse lives. We spare no effort. We even risk looking foolish for the great joy and privilege of praising the surpassing greatness of God. And then verse 6 tells us who is to praise God. Okay, this is very obvious, but I'm going to say it anyway. Everyone has the responsibility and everyone has the opportunity to praise God. Since we must shortly breathe our last, while we have breath on this earth, let us praise the Lord. And then when we breathe our last, we breathe and come. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Our worship life as a church faces many challenges. And perhaps the biggest challenge, and when we talk about throughout this series, is the fact that the world has changed. American culture is now radically different than it was 50 or 60 years ago. So here's a question, a quiz. What's the difference between the Amish and Presbyterians? You know the Amish, right? So what's the difference between Amish and Presbyterians? The answer is 100 years. The Amish are a Christian sect stuck in the 1850s. Presbyterians are a Christian sect stuck in the 1950s. That's the difference. But you can put almost any American denomination in there. The 1950s and 60s were the golden years of American church life. With relatively little effort, the pews were filled, Sunday schools were bursting at the seams. But the American landscape has changed, and today, according to the American Church Research Project, only 17.3% of the population actually attends the church. Now, interestingly enough, more than twice as many say they go to church. But in terms of attendance records, on any given Sunday or weekend, only 17.3% of the American population goes to church. Now, Michigan, though, is better. Oh, we are so much better. We're 19.5. Jill Hudson, who I mentioned earlier in the series, when better isn't enough. Jill Hudson comments, yet in many ways the church continues with business as usual, making plans as if we could will the 1950s back into existence. Lauren Mead, the founder of the Albert Institute, has this observation. I find many of my colleagues going on as they always have. I see people and institutions making plans for tomorrow as if it will be a replica of yesterday. Where I do see energy for facing difficulties, I find little sense of urgency. I get the sense that people hope it'll all go away if we just keep our heads down and keep putting one foot ahead. Western culture. Postmodernists do not like the church, even though they know almost nothing about it. Now, it's not easy for those of us in the church to understand and respond to the postmodern culture. It demands that we re-examine both what we do and why we do it. Hudson remarks, responding to postmodernism strikes the great core of our being and requires that once again we open ourselves to God's transformation. If we are not willing to do so, we risk becoming isolated from the culture in which we live, inviting stagnation and further decline. The question before us is, will the church in the postmodern world become a museum?
They were told that
to talk about worshiping God in a personal way. Worship is not intended to be a religious exercise. You're not supposed to go through with this pain look on your face. It's a relational experience with the living Lord. But too often we're like that country boy at the conclusion of his first date, standing under the porch light of the girl's front door. The boy looked at her and said, "May I kiss you?" And the girl smiled but said nothing. Then the boy said, "May I kiss you?" And again the girl smiled but said nothing. "Are you deaf?" asked the boy. "Are you paralyzed?" asked the girl. "Are you paralyzed?" Such that you have never really shown your affection for God. What would it take to move you into a deeper, more intimate relationship with God? Do you realize? Do you understand that if you're a Christian, you have purchased at a great price? The Son of God has laid down his life for you. An innocent man has shed his blood for you. You have been rescued from the dominion of darkness. You have been forgiven of all your sins. You have been reconciled to God, your Creator. You have been sealed with the Holy Spirit. You have been made co-heirs with the Lord Jesus Christ. You have been given eternal life. All for free. Friends, we are God.